everyone. Good evening. So I'm sharing my screen. I hope you can see my screen. So I'll be sharing some slides with you. So we'll be going over this to make it easier for everyone to follow me. And I really want to begin with reciting salutations with salawat to the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I think this is this will be much befitting to begin with. And this talk, I really, probably I'll be avoiding academic jargons as much as I can. And based on what I can see from the methodology, Imam Tirmizi, despite the fact that he is a great scholar and very meticulous in terms of this, you know, standards, but he has a very particular approach when it comes to this book, which I will be talking about later. So I think this will be really a good start. So we will be starting with this salawat. Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi kulla makhtalafa al-malawan wa ta'aqab al-asran wa karrar al-jadidan wa istakbal al-farqadan wa balli ruhahu wa arwaha ahli baytihi minna at-tahiyyata wa s-salam وارحم مبارك وسلم عليه وعليهم كثيرا كثيرا إلى يوم الحشر والقرار اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد بحر أنوارك ومعدن أسرارك وعين عنايتك وشمس هدايتك وعروس مملكتك وأمن ولايتك ولسان محبتك وإمام حضرتك وخير خلقك وأحب الخلق إليك عبدك وحبيبك ورسولك النبي الأمي الذي ختمت به الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى ملائكتك المقربين من أهل السماوات وأهل الأرضين رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين والحمد لله رب العالمين. So we will begin with the very brief biography of Imam Al-Tirmidhi. Who is he? So we will be talking about this masterpiece on the beautiful appearance and characteristics of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it is important to know him a little bit. So his full name is Abu Isa Muhammad ibn Isa ibn Thawra Yazid Al-Tirmidhi. Was born in Uzbekistan. In modern times, so in Tirmiz, and he was traveling widely. So we are talking about centuries ago now. So being able to travel from Uzbekistan to Mecca, Medina, Basra, Kufa, Wasit, Ray, Iran. So it's a great effort to obtain knowledge from original sources. So among his teachers are great scholars, like everybody knows, Imam Bukhari is one of his teachers, Imam Muslim, Abu Dawud, among many other great scholars. He was born in 209 Hijra, after Hijra, and he died in Tirmiz again, and his tomb is in Tirmiz 70 years later. So he lived for 70 years. As I said, he is one of the Imam Bukhari's student, and he was his student for a long time. And Imam Bukhari had a great impact on his scholarship in terms of particularly understanding the deeper meanings of ahadith, not just understanding the reports, but understanding the deeper meanings. When it comes to Bukhari's collection, how he even titles, you know, chapters. Scholars have written books about that, the way he titled the chapters. We can see similar pattern and influence in Imam Tirmizi's books as well. He learned the hidden defects. This is one of the difficult tasks in hadith scholarship. So he is very, very competent scholar in that sense, Imam Tirmizi. And obviously, undoubtedly, he is learning those things from great scholar Imam Bukhari. To understand the influence of Bukhari on him and his impression on Bukhari, I think this sentence makes it clear. Imam Bukhari said that, "I have benefited from you more so than you have benefited from me." So there is a consensus, methodologically speaking, about his reliability as a hadith transmitter. He is a very trustworthy first-class hadith scholar. He even attained the title of Imam, which is one of the highest rank in hadith scholarship. Although we use this in a different settings and different means, this term Imam, but in hadith discipline, it's a very special term. And Imam Tirmizi has received that title. Imam Zahabi, who is one of the critics of hadith scholars, and he has a compendium of hadith transmitters biography, he says his Jami, Imam Tirmidhi's book, hadith collection, testify that he is an imam in hadith and possesses retentive memory and also knows fiqh very well. When he completed his Jami, Imam Tirmizi, when he completed his hadith collection, he presented it to scholars in Khorasan, Iraq, Hijaz, and they were very well pleased with it, and they commended and complimented it. So this is the elites of that time, you know, scholars of Islam in the third century of Hijra. They are located in this, you know, centers of Islamic scholarship, and they all praised his work. And he himself says, anyone who has this book in his home, it is as if he has the Prophet speaking in his home. Obviously, we need to make sure that we are reading, we are reviving the information, so Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is here among us. And Quran, in fact, in that regard says, وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ فِيكُمْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Know for sure that Allah's messenger, he is with you. So there is no doubt that he will be with us with his spirituality. He will be with us when we revive this information, and particularly when we talk about his beautiful characteristics and implement in our day-to-day life. So another scholar, he comments on Imam Tirmizi and Hakim al-Kabir. He quotes this. He says, Bukhari died. So he is Bukhari's student. After he died, he left no one in Khorasan, in that region, like Abu Isa, referring to Imam Tirmidhi, in knowledge, memorization, piety, and worldly renunciation. He wept until he became blind and remained in that condition for years. So scholarship, as well as this awe of God, having piety, living that lifestyle that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was living, is part and parcel of this scholar's life. So due to many years of rigorous travel in pursuit of sacred knowledge, as well as frequent weeping in awe of Allah, he became blind later on in his life, and he passed away in that situation. So some scholars, because of this meticulous scholarship, especially his competence in hidden defects, concealed, you know, defects, subtle defects in hadith, both in the chain or in the text of the hadith, he was able to decipher them, he was able to determine them. They say Imam Bukhari, Imam Tirmizi's Jami, Al-Jami al-Sahih, otherwise it is known as Sunan al-Tirmidhi, he is the third most reliable hadith collection right after Bukhari and Muslim, as I said, due to his authority in those kind of disciplines. He had a great contribution, and two of them are quite significant. One is the term Hasan, he introduced in hadith discipline, is an intermediary term between Sahih and Da'if. So you find a very little defect in the hadith. It is not really affecting the text of the hadith, but because there is a defect prior to Imam Tirmizi, mostly it was recorded as a Da'if hadith, a weak report, and there, it should be perfect to be considered as Sahih hadith. Imam Tirmizi, he coined a term called Hasan, which kind of clarifies the defect and says, you know, because of this minor issue, we cannot disregard this hadith and say it is a weak report, so we should not take into consideration. He says we should have an intermediary, you know, evaluation, and that is Hasan, a great contribution. Another great contribution is the term Shama'il, that we will be talking in a moment. So he has so many works, and some of them are here. His collection in Kutub-i Sitte, as we said, right after Bukhari and Muslim, one of the most reliable hadith collections among the six most authentic hadith collections. Shama'il, we will be talking about that. Ilal, as we said, he is quite a great scholar in that, in finding the hidden defects in hadith, and he has some other works. Let's start talking about the Shama'il, the purpose of the scattering, I think. I really like this quote. Mulla al-Qari, great Hanafi jurist and great hadith scholar, he is complimenting on Imam Tirmizi's book as such. And just the let's note that Imam Mulla Ali al-Qari is one of the most important commentators of Imam Tirmizi's Shama'il as well. And his commentary is widely circulated and very well respected. He says the among the books written on his description, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an excellent conduct is the short compendium written by Imam Tirmidhi, which completely gathers his hagiography in such a way that it is as if the person who reads this book is looking directly at his noble face, and with each chapter witnessing his beautiful, noble characteristics. So we will be trying to understand this book, you know, what this book is about and what are the most important qualities of this book. So let's begin with the term Shama'il, how this term came into existence in terms of hadith discipline or in relation to the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So lexically, when you look at the dictionary Arabs, centuries ago, they use this term as a trait. It has a lot of meaning and sometimes competing meanings. But in the context of what we are now speaking, there are two important things. One is about qualities, character traits of a person and nature of something. That is quite important. And when it comes to our subject, it is the characteristics of the Prophet, his noble characteristics, his traits, his nature, inner and outer dimensions. But another important meaning of this term is to search for water, to quench the thirst. So, and when the Arabs use this term, they give this analogy. Imagine you are living in a desert, in a barren desert. Nothing is around. And you are in dire need of water. So you need to quench your thirst. And how, you know, put yourself in that situation, not, you know, when you go and open the tap, turn and you are able to drink. So imagine you living in desert and you are in absolute need of water, and going and pouring water from a well, from a spring, suddenly how much you will be affected and how much you are in need of that. So that quench for thirst is Shama'il. So why Imam Tirmizi is using this term to title his book about the life, noble characteristics of the Prophet? Because he is considering the situation of humanity before the arrival of the Prophet. They are in dire need of noble characters. You know, social and moral degradation reached the zenith, and that the era that Prophet ﷺ emerged is entitled as the age of ignorance. They are in complete need of this, you know, this source of water, this source of life, this source for inner peace, this source for their, you know, needs, and the compendium, the book that is going to talk about his beautiful face, that is going to describe us that well, that spring, that, you know, ocean, is entitled as a Shama'il. So terminologically speaking, then Shama'il is a work written about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, concerning the descriptions of his blessed being in terms of his outer and inner qualities. It is physical appearance of the Prophet. It is his clothing. It is his beautiful akhlaq. It is his generosity that embraces anyone and everyone. It is his love and compassion towards humanity. Anything that is about the life and the beauty of his personal appearance and his inner appearance, inner akhlaq, his inner and outer qualities is called Shema'il works due to that meaning. So the core of this genre, the core of this discipline is Prophet's traits, emanating from his heightened state of ihsan, of unwavering tawakkul and reliance on Allah in the face of unending tribulations. This is very important and relevant. In the course of Islamic history, when Muslims, they are in tribulations, they always went back to the noble life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They took refuge in his blessed beings. Anything, any remnants that is reaching us, they sought blessings, they sought some sort of a help through this blessed being. So they invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah granted them victory. Take over their difficulties and hardships. And I personally think we, as the children of 21st century, we as people who are going so much tribulations and problems, we who are really in need of this water source, in need of this great source to find solace, to find tranquility for our needs, we need to go back to his noble life. We need to go back to his shama'il, his akhlaq, his mannerism, to find solutions, to find some sort of a healing to problems that we are facing. Shama'il, in a sense, is a letter to ummah, to each and every one of us, to revive us. It does speak to us directly in a very immediate and pressing manner. When you open up any page of these books, these collections, you will see that it is talking to you. It is showing to you how you can be a best human being, how you can really be a great father, how you can be a great brother, how you can be a great mother, how you can be a great companion, how you can be a great supporter, how you can be a great worker, how you can be whatever you can think. You can find a lot of things talking directly to you, directly giving you advice, how you can get, you know, take out of this situation that you are facing difficulties. You say you are facing, you know, hardship. We will see, and you will see, that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is just nearby. It is as if you are living with him and he is giving you an advice. You lost some traits. You are in search of water. You are thirsty and he is granting you this water. Knowing Shama'il is a true means of filling one's heart with reverence for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Knowing Shama'il is knowing the Prophet's sublime beauty. His human beings are naturally, they love, they have a tendency towards beauty. Love emanates from various things. Firstly, it comes from something physically beautiful. You know, you look at, you know, even if you look at image, you know, there is a rose, image looks nice. So you have a love towards it naturally. Sometimes it emanates from inner dimensions, from characteristics. So that characteristics, you know, it really impacts you and you have an inclination towards that. And sometimes it is because of some of the favors. So when we look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when we think about Shama'il works, his physical descriptions, you will be attached to it. You will be loving him. When you think about his beautiful mannerism, you will definitely be amazed and you will be insane, you know, majnun of that person. And when you think about the blessings, favors He granted us. Quran says, لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ. It is a form of a very, very profound expression. This is a great favor, Allah says, that Allah has chosen someone among you. He is a bashar, he is a human being, somebody like me. That is the greatest favor. I know who am I. I know where I'm heading. I know what is my purpose. So this is a great, great blessing. So when I study Shama'il, all reasons of love are really, reflected in that person. How come I cannot love him? How come I cannot be attached to him? How come I cannot really take some lessons and some teachings from his beautiful life? Knowing Shama'il is a prerequisite to properly understand Islam and Islam in general and the Prophet and his life in particular. When we study Sirah, when I teach Sirah in our courses, for instance, we generally list 14 different disciplines how one can really truly understand and appreciate the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Among them are Shama'il, obviously. When you study his life, when you study from these original works, you don't really, have an assumption or impose your socially constructed, thinking on the seerah. You understand from the source who he is and how he should be understood without really imposing anything to that. So it is a very important prerequisite to understand our religion and to understand the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When we think about Shama'il as a discipline, in fact, Quran is one of the first Shama'il books. I sometimes actually think that before the Quran, even previous scriptures, when we think about previous scriptures, one of the important components of those books is predictions about the upcoming Prophet. Even those sources have benefit of talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When you study Sirah, you will see a lot of times people have an anticipation of upcoming Prophet. There is a prediction. That's why so many people came and they settled in Medina waiting for a Prophet. As soon as they saw him, they said, this is the one who is mentioned in our sources. This is the one we are waiting for years to come, so we can find solutions to our problems. So coming back to the Quran, and obviously Quran is introducing his beautiful character. When asked to Aisha, can you talk about the akhlaq of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Her immediate response was, don't you recite the Quran? Don't you read the Quran? His akhlaq is the Quran. He is a walking Quran. So when Anas ibn Malik, once he looked at the Prophet's beauty, he gazed at his blessed face and looked at a page of the Quran, and he said, it really looks like a page in the Quran. It has a very deep meaning to really understand what Anas is really talking about. So he is a walking Quran for sure. So coming to Imam, this is what we can generally understand from the Shama'il sources. When it comes to Imam Tirmidhi's Shama'il, this is one of the famous and most important collections about the moral, physical, and spiritual perfection of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is perfect human being in any sense. And through him, we really understand perfection. Through him, we understand the perfection of the Creator. So he is such a mirror that reflects that perfection in utmost sense, in his inner and outer qualities. There is no single doubt about this. His beautiful appearance, his lifestyle, his character is documented in this hadith. He used this term for the first time for the reasons I have given before when I was talking about the lexical meaning of Shama'il. So Shama'il, in this book, we learn how Prophet looked like, how Prophet was walking, how Prophet was talking, how Prophet was engaging with people, young, old, you know, poor, wealthy. So we read through Shema'il the persona of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it really provides an ultimate context for developing a deep, holistic appreciation of the message and the messenger at the same time. It is intended to be a devotional text. So Imam Tirmizi is a great hadith scholar. In his Jami, after he documents a hadith, he provides a lot of information, methodological information and evaluation of the hadith text. When we open this text of Shama'il, although it is largely quoted in his collection as well, we see that he doesn't exercise that. He wanted this to be a love expression of love. When you open the very first chapter of the book, it talks about the appearance, the countenance, the beautiful face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is his intention, to attract people's attention to his personality. A look at his face is going to change you for eternity. So he has that devotional motivation, really, when he is documenting this collection of hadith that talks about his physical, spiritual, and moral qualities. Shama'il, in that sense, is an outpouring of deep and profound love, as if a lover goes to such length to describe his beloved masterfully. So it is an undeniable manifestation of Imam Tirmizi's love through documented collections, obviously, through the sources, authentic sources, his love is manifested in this document. It is a compilation of 415 hadiths, prophetic sayings, and it has a 56 chapters. How he kind of allocates chapters is quite interesting. He allocates a chapter about the number of the white hairs in the Prophet's head. For a reason. I don't know how many white hairs I have in my head. You know, I have many, but because this person is so important, and companions, those who are living around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they knew the importance of this person. They understood him very well, and they documented and recorded everything and anything about him. We don't have that minute details about anyone in the course of history. So he lived 14 centuries ago, and we, through these books, as Imam Mullah Qari was saying, you know, we as if we are looking at his beautiful face, as if we are in his presence, and as if we are witnessing a companionship to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in this sense, Ibrahim al-Bajuri, Egyptian, imam and great scholar, he says it is the only book in its genre, unique in its arrangement and content, so much so that it is considered divinely gifted and has been disseminated in the East and West. From my just little search, I found over 60 books written on Imam Tirmizi's Shama'il, to actually comment on this book. So you can understand the amount of works produced on only this one. I'm not talking about other books written on Shama'il. So you can imagine, you know, countless books written in that respect. For scholars, this book has something to say. And for ordinary people like me, this book also has something to say. For scholars, this work stands as a reminder for their responsibility as a true heir of the Prophet. They are warith, al-ulama warathatul anbiya. Scholars are the heirs of the prophets. So they look at this type of books and they question themselves. Am I attaining those standards? Am I implementing the teachings and the beauty and the qualities and the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in my affairs. That is a great kind of lesson and great kind of accountability that is given to the scholars when they read this kind of books. Those who read this account would be humbled and would begin to see the shortcomings of his or her own self, vowing to rectify them. It is, you know, we are having this, you know, questioning for a good purpose, not to blame us, but to better us in our interactions with our children, in our interactions with our family members, in our interactions with our colleagues, and what so and so and so forth. For ordinary believer, this book should be a companion, constant companion, frequented and studied until the memory of the generous prophet becomes imprinted on their heart and mind, providing clarity and certainty on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So after this long discussion, I really want to take you to the first chapter, at least, of this book, give you an example how scholars, how companions, they talked about the physical beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this perfect man, and also his great characteristics, noble qualities of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This kind of frames called Hilya al-Sharif, you know, Ottomans, they kind of they frame this kind of thing. It has been used as a template. Pretty much same format is used, but this is something important. Muslims, they don't depict images of the great people like prophets, but they depicted his picture through words. They depicted the picture of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through words. And Ottomans, they introduced this kind of great frames to hang on the walls of their houses, to embellish their houses, to protect their houses, as well as to remind every single moment they look at this kind of, you know, frames, so they can remember the beautiful life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and once again question how close they are living by with his teachings and morals. So this is the first chapter of this book. The very, very first chapter of the book talks about the physical features of the Messenger of God. So the first chapter entitled What Has Been Narrated in Relation to Physical Features of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When we look at these kind of books, very close companions, like in this report, we will hear from Ali radiallahu anh, Prophet's son, you know, his son-in-law, his cousin, Ali radiallahu anh, talks about that. In another report, we will be visiting another son. This is a stepson, the son of Khadija radiallahu anha, is talking about the Prophet. We will hear Anas ibn Malik talking about the Prophet. I kind of see these people as cameras of the prophetic life. They are recording everything in such a detail that fascinates you how talented these people are and how gifted these people are, and it gives us an impression that it wasn't coincident that Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam emerged among these people. So when Ali radiallahu an, Hassan, his son, is narrating that when Ali radiallahu an described the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would say, the Messenger of Allah was neither extremely tall nor extremely short. He was of medium stature among his people. So if somebody is tall, you know, I have seen the tallest man, according to the records in the world, he's I don't know if it has changed, the Turkish guy. So it doesn't look normal, right? If somebody is very, very short, it doesn't look normal too. So he is a medium. This is the general thing. You know, he always possesses this, you know, balance and medium thing. so everybody can relate to him. He was of medium stature among his people. His blessed hair was neither extremely curly nor straight. Rather, it was slightly wavy. He was not corpulent. His blessed face was not completely circular, but was slightly round. His complexion was fair and imbued with a bit of redness. His blessed eyes were very black, and his eyelashes were long. His blessed joints were large, and his blessed shoulders were broad. He was not hirsute. A thin line of hair ran from his blessed chest to his navel. His blessed hands and feet were full-fledged and sturdy. When he walked with vigor, as if descending a height. When he would turn to look at someone or something, he would turn with his whole body. Between his blessed shoulders was the seal of prophethood, and he is the seal of the prophets. His blessed heart was the soundest and most generous of hearts. His speech is the most truthful speech. He is the gentlest of all people in nature and truthful and noblest of them in social interactions and companionship. Whoever saw him unexpectedly awestruck. Whoever interacted with him, his knowing him would love him. The one who would describe him would say, I saw neither before him or after him anyone like him. So the last expression is, you know, you cannot really define, you cannot describe him. There is no, this is a kind of an ajiz. Companions, they took refuge in, you know, there is no word really. Ultimately, that's how Ali radiallahu wanted to say, there is no word to describe him. Another very nice description, it's coming from, this is a long one, it is hadith number 8 from the Tirmizi's collection. So I'm not sure, should I go through this Sister Mashid? It looks like I only have 1 minute.
Yeah, I was gonna say you have a minute, but I'll leave it up to you. You can have a few more minutes. It's okay, because we don't have too many questions. So I can give you a few more minutes.
Okay, I'll stop and you read it. If you don't mind, you will say.
No, it's okay. I prefer to listen and close my eyes.
Okay. All right. This comes from Hassan radiallahu anhu, Hassan ibn Ali, who reported, I asked my maternal uncle Hind ibn Abi Hala. So Hind ibn Abi Hala, Abu Hala is Khatija's husband before Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Hind is stepson for the Prophet, maternal uncle for Hassan, obviously, because, you know, Fatma's, you know, a brother is this person who was skilled. This is very important. Hind ibn Abi Hala, who was skilled in describing features about a beautiful description of the Messenger of Allah. He is wasaf. Arabs has certain qualities. You know, we need to allocate a lecture why Prophet emerged in Arabia among Arab people. It's not about, you know, local message or whatnot. It's about those skills they possess. So look how this person is describing. You know, he is a very skillful person describing something. And you can see the competence and expertise in the expressions of this person. When you listen carefully, you know, and read these lines, it is extraordinary. So he says, because this person, Hassan, he knows that this person is very talented in describing someone. And remember, Prophet, he lived with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when Khatija, when Prophet married to Khatija, this person is in the household. So, and years later, he is reporting these things to Hassan radiallahu anhu. I desired for him to describe some of his features to me so I could cherish and hold on to them. He said, the messenger of Allah was magnificent in himself and magnificent in the eyes of others. His blessed face shone like the light of the full moon on a moonlight night. Moon for Arabs, you need to know, you know, it's not the scorching heat of sun, you know, in the desert. Full moon is a manifestation of beauty and solace. So he's saying he is like a full moon. Many companions describe the Prophet's face like that. So he was taller than a man of average height, yet shorter than an extremely tall man. His blessed head was large and his blessed hair was wavy. If the hair on the front of his blessed head parted easily, he would part it in the middle. And if it did not, he would leave it as it was. When he would leave his blessed hair, it would fall past his earlobes. His complexion was fair and luminous. His blessed forehead was wide. His blessed eyebrows were arched thin, long and full, perfectly shaped without connection. Between them was a vein that anger would cause to pulsate. His blessed nose was prominent, long with a thin tip and slight curvature in the middle. It was aquiline. A light rose from it, and one who did not look closely at him would think that it was raised high and straight with the tip of the nose slightly prominent. His blessed beard was full and dense. His cheeks were smooth. His mouth was wide, and between his blessed front teeth was a slight space. A thin line of hair ran from his blessed chest to his navel. His blessed neck was like that of any ivory statue, resplendent as silver. His physique was evenly proportionate. He was well built and firm, and his blessed chest and stomach were even with each other. His blessed chest and shoulders were broad, and his blessed joints were proportionately large. His blessed limbs that were unclothed shone brightly. Beside the thin line of hair that ran from his blessed upper chest to his navel, neither his breast nor his stomach had hair. His blessed arms and shoulders and upper chest, however, had hair. He had long forearms and wide palms and full-fleshed, sturdy hands and feet. His blessed fingers and toes were long and well proportionate, or he said, his blessed fingers and toes were not crooked or bulging. And he had slight arc in the soles of his blessed feet. His blessed feet were smooth, such that water could run right off them if poured. This is not normally in that Arabian thing, you know, it would have been damaged, and I don't know. When he walked, he would lift his blessed feet with vigor and would lean towards slightly and would tread lightly. He had a naturally long stride, and walking, it was as if he was descending on height. When he would turn to look at someone or something, he would turn with his whole body. He would lower his gaze, and he would look at the ground more than he would look into the sky. Most of his looking was from the corner of his blessed eye. He would have his companions walk in front of him and would initiate greetings of peace, salam, with whomever he met. So this, as Imam Mullah Qari was saying, we are looking at his beautiful, you know, appearance, right? When you read it, and obviously we should contemplate and remember this much. So another report sample I took here that talks about this is physical appearance. The other one is inner qualities. I'll leave this one slide open. So this is chapter 48. So hadith number 351, which talks about his inner qualities, his interaction with people. So that is also amazing.